Pennsylvania German Hour is underwritten by die Pennsylvanische Deutsche Versammlung von Baddocks County, the state's largest annual Pennsylvania Dutch language gathering, held the first Monday after Easter in the Leesport Auction Hall. For more information, please call Joyce Hassler at 717-866-3431. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the West Berks Versammlung, held annually on the first Saturday in October in Robesonia. For more information, please call Kathy Shellhammer at 610-390-1088. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the Rentschler-Leib family and Reverend Richard Miller and family. The Pennsylvania German Hour is produced in cooperation with the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center at Kutztown University, the hub of Pennsylvania Dutch culture and language. Contact us at 610-683-1589. Or at www.kutztown.edu/pgchc. Mir soll a gross dank zu alle unser Unterstützer.
Gute Maria und willkommen zum Pennsylvanisch Deutschstund, der Bestplatz für Deutschzuhörer auf BCTV. Heute ist der 7. August 2020 und die Sommer ist heiß und auch deswegen wenig nass. Wir haben früher das Volk ein wenig wischt garstiges Wetter von dem Hurricane Isaias, 6 Zoll Rehe in Redding letzter Sonntag und noch 5 Zoll mehr am Dienstag. Ai, 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 es Jahr 2020 ist fast sure etwas abartiges. Des Monat ist der 5. Monat, als ich der Pennsylvanische Deutschstunde bei mir selber am Du bin, weil des Jahr ist nicht gleich wie andere Jahre vor die Show auf BCTV, dünne mir noch viel. Wäre unser Spruch, Kultur und Spaß, aber nicht einige Lieder von unserem Chor, der Neue Doppelhack Sängerchor. Ich vermisse alle die gute Leute im Chor und hoffentlich in Zukunft können wir ein paar Recordings von Ihnen bringen, für auf die Show zu usen. Heute wollen wir einen guten Freund bewillkommen zu BCTV, der Douglas Madenford. Er ist schon wohl bekannt zu viel von unserer lieben Gugge. Und ist ein Deutschschulmeister online für PA Dutch 101 on YouTube.com, ein Hochschul-Hochdeutsch-Teacher, aber auch ein Author, Schreiber, Musikanter und überall ein guter Mensch mit viel Lieb für unsere Sprache und Kultur. Es letztes Mal, wann auf dem Pennsylvanischen Deutschstund war, hat viel deutsche Lieder gesungen mit seiner Band Broken Spokes, mit seinem Mitspieler Chris LaRose. Die zwei Calls hat immer eine badig gute Zeit gedu, gleich wie alle ihre wichtige out of it. Alle beide dunne sie der popular YouTube Show Ask a Dutchman und viel andere Dinge. Willkommen, Doug. Willkommen, Bruder. Wie bist du heute?
Ich bin euch gut und ich bin euch froh, do zu sein. Desmal muss ich nicht so weit vor, auf die Show zu kommen. Aber ich hab mich in mein Keller und ich hab ein Kuppchen Kaffee dabei. Und es ist wirklich gut, do zu sein. Gross Dank, Patrick.
Wunderbar. Es ist ein großes Ehr für dich haben bei uns heute. Und kommt es nicht grad wie ein Surprise vielleicht, aber heute ist es ist mein große Ehr, für ein Award dir zu rausgeben im Namen von der Deutsch-Pennsylvanisches Arbeitskreis, oder DPEC, for short. Unsere Mitschaffer in Europe haben alle eingestimmt für das Pennsylvanisch-Deutsches Kulturpreis, die Award for Outstanding Pennsylvania German Activities, und sie geben große Ehre zu dir und die Rachel Yoder für ihre abartig wunderbare Mitarbeit für die Deutschsprache zu erhalten, durch ihre Bilderbücher Davey Applebutter und Penny Olive. Ja, einen guten Job gedu mit ihre und mir ehre euch davor. Congratulations, Doug.
Gross Dank, und ich muss ehrlich sagen, gross Dank an die Leute von DPEC. Das war wirklich gut, das zu kriegen. Und so ein Ehr ist es. Es ist wirklich ein Ehr für mich. Ich tue, was ich tue, nicht für die Award zu kriegen. Ich tue, was ich tue, für die Leute, Pennsylvanisch Deutsch zu mehr zu wissen, zu üben, zu lernen, ein Connection zu machen. Und wenn so ein Award dann kommt, so ein Preis, dann das ist your icing on the cake, sozusagen. Aber gross Dank.
Ja, und groß Dank zu dir für alle deine wichtige Arbeit. Und well, mit alles, was ihr getan habt, habt ihr für sure es wohl verdient.
Doch, groß Dank.
Congratulations, noch einmal. Ja. So, heute habe ich ein paar Frohe für dich, ein little bit of an interview zu tun. Mhm. Und so, ich habe ein paar Frohe für dich heute. Sag uns mal ein wenig, wer Davey Applebutter, Penny Olive und die wichtige Mitarbeit mit der Rachel Yoder.
Ja, so die Penny Olive war erst. Die Rachel hat mir ein E-Mail geschrieben und hat gesagt, oh, ich schaffe auf ein Kinderbuch. Und ich habe, oh, das ist eigentlich gut. Wir haben nicht so viele Kinderbücher in Pennsylvania Deutsch. Und sie hat gesagt zu mir, vielleicht wäre es cool, wenn wir so Englisch und Deutsch in das Buch haben. Ja, das ist eine gute Idee, denke ich, ja. So dann haben wir entschieden, so wir wäre well, A-Blatt ist Englisch und dann dreht das Buch rum und dann ist es das Pennsylvania Deutsch. Die gleiche Geschichte mit den gleichen Pictures, aber einmal in Englisch und dann einmal in Deutsch. Und die Idee war dann, dass wenn ein Großelder und ein Elder Deutsch lesen kennt, dann sie können es mal zu den Kindern lesen. Und dann hat den Bild, die Pictures auch dabei. Und das Penny Olive war gut gekommen, denke ich. Viele Leute haben gesagt, weil sie haben es auch geglichen. Und ich habe dann noch ein paar Zeit zu der Rachel gesagt, hey, willst du ein anderes Buch mit mir schreiben? Sie hat gerade gesagt, ja, du nochmal das. So, die Rachel hat Penny Olive geschrieben und ich habe sie ihr ersetzt. Und sie hat all die Pictures gedoet. Und dann ich habe die Idee von ein Kinderbuch mit einem Boo als der Main Character. Und weil die Penny Olive war ein Mädel. Und das Mal habe ich den Geschichte geschrieben, Davey Applebutter, und dann die Rachel hat all die Pictures dann wieder gedoet. Und es war, sie ist so gut mit die Pictures und das Buch ist so schön, denke ich. Und es hat, ja, die Geschichte natürlich hat etwas mit Pennsylvania Deutsch zu tun, aber die Pictures haben auch dann viel mit den Pennsylvania Deutsch zu tun, mit den Scheierstanne und die Geschichte läuft mit dem Kind, die besucht sein Großelders Bauerei und wie es Leben ist für einen Bauer und wie man schaffen muss und so einen eher an unsere Vorältere und wie sie gelebt haben. Und ja, in alle zwei Bücher, also Davey Applebutter ist dann rausgekommen dadurch Masthof Press, so man muss ja auch groß Dank zu Masthof Press sagen, weil sie haben die zwei Bücher gedrückt für uns und dann auch verkauft für uns. Und viel Leute haben mich schon E-Mails oder Messages in Facebook geschrieben und hat gesagt, als sie wirklich mit ihr Großeltern, also die Enkeln oder die Kinder, diese Bücher gelesen haben. Und das für mich ist eigentlich wunderbar. Eigentlich cool, sozusagen. So ich bin wirklich froh. Es war ganz gut, mit die Rachel zu schaffen. Wir verstehen uns alle ziemlich gut und wir können gut Feedback zueinander geben. Und ja, sie ist so talented, so begabt. Sie hat so ein Arc für das, besser als ich. Und das finde ich ganz cool. Und ich hoffe, dass über dem in Zukunft können wir dann ein drittes Buch über dem rausbringen. Wollen wir mal sehen.
Wunderbar. Well, alle ihr, alle beide, haben ein lot Talent und so viel gute Job gedoet mit Sally Becher, Davey Applebutter, ai, Zellis Wunderbar und Penny Olive. So, die Kinder haben sie wohl geglicken, Zellis yeah. Bohr. So, gut, wunderbar. All right, my next frog für dich. Du hast den neuen Podcast, Doug's Front Porch, gemacht.
Ich hab.
Now, was ist es und wie lang ist es am Gay?
Ja, so erst muss ich sagen, es hat eigentlich nichts mit Pennsylvania Deutsch zu tun. Es ist alles auf Englisch. Schon sehr lang habe ich gewollt, einen Podcast zu haben. Ich höre viel Podcasts und ich bin ein großer Fan von Podcasts. Ich habe gedacht, über dem will ich einen Podcast haben. Und in Quarantäne für Covid habe ich ein bisschen mehr Freizeit gehabt und habe gedacht, vielleicht na, ist eine gute Zeit für das zu tun. Und ich habe die Idee gehabt, es wäre just ein Geschwätz, ein Geschwätzstund. So jeder Stück ist ich und eine andere Person und wir schwätzen miteinander. Ganz einfach. Und wir schwätzen ein bisschen über ihr Leben, ihre Erfahrungen ins Leben, was wichtig zu ihnen im Leben ist. Und ich denke, dass in unserer Zeit na, wir brauchen mehr Schwätze miteinander. Vielleicht, wenn wir miteinander mehr schwätzen, wäre es nicht so viel Trubel geben. Weil ich glaube wirklich, dass viel Leid, vielleicht auf die rechte Seite oder auf die linke Seite von dem politischen Spektrum, es gibt mehr Leid in die Mitte. Und wir verstehen uns viel mehr, als was wir denken. Aber wir schwätzen nicht miteinander. Und ich habe gedacht, vielleicht, wenn ich dieses Podcast rausbringe und man kann hören, oh, es sind zwei Karls oder ich und ein Frau und wir schwätzen just schwätzen, dass vielleicht wird das ein bisschen Freude bringen für Leute, zwei Leute zu hören und ganz einfach zu schwätzen miteinander. Gerade wie auf dem Front Porch, auf meiner Bauerei, wo ich aufgewachsen bin, wir haben einen großen Front Porch gehabt. Und da haben wir gehockt und geschwätzt. Ganz einfach. Und ich glaube, wir brauchen mehr von das in unserer Welt heutzutage. So, das ist die Idee von dieses Podcast. Und ich habe schon 8 Stück raus. Sie kommen jede 1. und 15. von der Monat kommt raus. So ein neuer Stück kommt am 1. August raus mit einem guten Freund von mir. Und ja, mal sehen, wie weit es geht. Aber bis soweit, ich habe viel gute Comments gekriegt von Leuten, die es schon gehört haben. Und wir machen mal so weiter dann.
Wie können die Leute es hier online? Hast du ja ein URL oder etwas Schönes?
Alles ist mit Buzzsprout. So wenn man in Google geht und tippt mal Doug's Front Porch, dann findet man es. Aber wenn du schon, wenn etwas schon einen Podcast kriegt von Apple oder Spotify oder Google, my Doug's Front Porch ist auch dort. Du kannst mal ganz subscriben und dann kommt es gerade in dein Feed, sozusagen. Kostlos, mit alles kostet.
Ja, zelles etwas für die deutsche Leute. Mir gleiche viel Dinge, es kostet nichts. Zelles gut. So, ich bin eifrig für jetzt hier. So, wunderbar. Alright, so my next frog for dich. So du hast viel Bücher gedu, Musik zu spielen, ein neuer Podcast gemacht. So was schönst bist am du heidestag, weil die COVID-19 ist da rum.
Ich mache also neue Videos für mein YouTube Channel. Ich schwätze viel mit viel Leid in Deutschland dadurch Facebook. Und ich denke, das ist etwas, das von den COVID-19 so viel Leid war heim, hat nichts zu tun. Und Facebook ist, ja, viel Leid hasse es, viel Leid liebe es. Aber für mich, Facebook war ein guter Platz zu gehen mit Leid aus dem Pals oder aus Hesse in Freundschaft zu machen. Und wir haben miteinander oft schwätze und so ein Idea-Exchange. Und das war wirklich gut. So ich verbringe ein bisschen Zeit auf dem Facebook mit viel Leid aus Europe. Und viel von den Leuten hat gesagt, wir wollen über dem nach Pennsylvania kommen. So das ist auch etwas gut, das rausgekommen ist. Natürlich nah ist nicht die Zeit, für sie rüberzukommen. Aber in die Zukunft, wenn die Covid vorbei ist, dann, ich glaube, mehr und mehr Leute wären von Deutschland nach Pennsylvania kommen, von Tourism, und sie wollen alles über Pennsylvanisch Deutschland. Sie sind so eifrig über alles. Sie will es sehen, sie will es hören, sie will in den S-Platz essen, sie will zu Dietrichs Meats gehen und das wirklich sehen. Und sie kann es nicht glauben, dass wir so in Spruch und Kultur do in Pennsylvania haben. Und sie sind so eifrig da zu kommen. Und das finde ich auch wirklich gut. Und ich glaube, dass wenn alles vorbei ist, wir alle werden Wanderlust haben und wir werden mal raus über dem und Race machen. Und hoffentlich dann gibt es auch Leute von Pennsylvania, die denken, well, ich will auch nach Deutschland gehen und sehen, wo mein Groß-Groß-Groß-Story rauskommen ist. Und vielleicht wäre das auch sowas zu geschehen. Mal sehen.
Ja, mal sehen. Und sehr so gut für gute Freunde zu haben über die Atlantik mit viel Dingen, was wir zusammenkommen können. Da wäre ja. Ja. So, ich hab ein Frage für dich, das nicht auf meine Liste ist, aber ich sehe etwas gerade hinter dich, auf dem Band. Du hast alle Orte Gleibilder von vielleicht ein Urgroßvater, ein Urgroßmami oder etwas sonst. Was sind alle die Leute auf dem Band?
Well, vielleicht kann ich mein Computer gleich ein bisschen drehen. Während der Covid-Zeit habe ich gedacht, ich habe ein bisschen Freizeit. Ich habe all diese alten Pictures von meiner Familie gehabt und sie waren alle in Bücher oder in Box. Und ich habe gedacht, ich muss mal ein paar Mal rausbringen und auf den Band stecken. So, ich und meine Frau, wir haben so Collages gemacht, sozusagen. So, das ist alle die Madenford-Pictures aus meiner Madenford-Familie, Freundschaft. Und dann der nächste ist dann auf meiner Mami's Seite, die Bauers. Bauers und Ungers, so all die Familie dort. Und dann, dort ist auf mein, die Hochs, mein Großmami waren Hoch aus Oli, und das sind all die Hochs dort, die Hochfamilie und Feglis und ein paar andere Freundschaften dort auf das. So, ja, so all die Pictures, und ich stehe oft und ich guck, ich habe sie 100 Mal geguckt, aber ich gucke sie immer noch. Und dann andere all die Pictures, von der Familie, von der Freundschaft.
Ja, und sie kennen alle sehen, was du bist.
Recht.
Sie sind ganz stolz für dich.
Ich hoffe. Ja. Die alle drei Räume sind voll mit Deutschen. Es ist alle deutsche Namen. Ich habe auch auf das gedenkt, dass da hocke ich und ich mache was. Da ist, wo ich schaffe, ins Keller für meine Videos und andere Dinge. Und sie sind immer... Oder alles fährt immer über meine Achsel und sie gucken immer, alles fährt das vor sich tue. Und ich hoffe dann mal, ja, sie sind mal stolz. Ich hoffe mal.
Ja, so gebacht.
Ja, recht.
Behef dich.
Ja.
So, jetzt letztendlich, als ich dir fragen muss, was denkst du über die neue Gewöhnlichkeit oder die neue Normal und wie es trifft unsere deutsche Kultur und die Sprache. Yeah. Was denkst du von selbst?
I want to go a little deeper on this, so I'm going to switch to English.
Do it. That's fine.
You know,
I'll repeat the question too.
Yeah.
But we're going to answer the question in English. Maybe I'll just say, and those of you who maybe are watching today who can't understand all of the Pennsylvania Dutch, you probably at least caught the word new normal in there. I was asking Doug, what do you think about the effect of this idea of the new normal and how it's going to perhaps change or affect things relating to the culture and the language, the way we celebrate, the way we do things? So I'll open the floor up to you, Doug.
You know, it's none of us can see into the future and know for sure what's going to happen.
You can?
I can. I know some people that think they can, but, this time, I think for a lot of people since March has afforded us the opportunity to be a little bit introspective and retrospective as well, and where we fit in the bigger picture. And maybe for some people, it was almost religious experiences in some aspects that they truly had a time to sit down and think about things. I always look, being a student of history as well, I look at every major catastrophe or crisis in history has changed societies, sometimes for the bad, and also sometimes for the better, a lot of times for the better. I think in the end, when all of this is over, at least I hope, one thing that will come out of it is that we as a society can be a little bit more humane to each other and understanding of each other. I think if anything that we've been going through the last couple of months, and not just COVID, but also all of the political and social unrest in our country, I'm hoping that we can come out of this as a people more united, because we definitely need a little bit more unity in our society. And the way that I think we can do that is particularly through what we're doing, what you do, what I do. And that might sound counterintuitive for saying, well, you want to teach about a culture and you want to teach about how it's different and how it's unique. But I think that what we need to impress upon people is that the work that we do and Pennsylvania Dutch culture and language and history is unique to the American tapestry, but it's also a part of that tapestry. And I like to tell people, you know, we have I do what I do, but I love to hear about people that are in Louisiana that are doing the same thing for the Creole language, or people that are in Texas that are trying to support Texas German, you know, that dialect that's down there. Mm. And I think it tells the story of, and I think it also reminds Americans that we all do come from different backgrounds, and we all have different roots, but in the end, we're all on the same soil. And for the most part, we as a people in this country have been able to get along with each other. And I'm hoping that coming out of this, we can secure that and make it even stronger than what it was. And by highlighting our differences and our unique aspects, I think that can also hopefully bring more appreciation to the people that maybe aren't Pennsylvania Dutch and say, well, here's this unique culture that has been able to survive and is still surviving. And how do they fit in to my culture, or how can our two cultures get along and actually work together to make a better, stronger in America? I know it seems it's waxing eloquently and maybe a little bit of pie-eyed in that, but I think we have to dream like that. Otherwise, I don't think we ever make any forward progress in any direction. I mean, what are your thoughts? I mean, I'm sure you've sat and thought about this as well over the last couple months.
Oh, yes. And part of what we're currently doing at the Heritage Center is we're really working to try to do as much as we can online. We're in the process of trying to create virtual tours, virtual galleries, ways that people can get resources for the classroom, that public school teachers, as well as professors at the university can make use of the center remotely. And part of what we're really hoping to do is strengthen those stories that we are telling and clarify these stories that we are part of a very distinctive cultural group within a broader region of individuals,
right,
who all share in these traditions many times, regardless of whether you're Pennsylvania Dutch or not. If you live within southeastern Pennsylvania, you're affected by the culture in one way, shape, or form. And it just goes to show that we need to especially emphasize that this isn't just work for us as people who might be descendants of a certain limited number of people who emigrated at a certain time, but really a broader understanding about how we all fit together. Pennsylvania at one point in time was the most diverse of the 13 original colonies. And this is a really important legacy for Pennsylvania. Of course, many folks are familiar with the fact that German-speaking people were invited to come here by William Penn. William Penn embraced this idea of the Holy Experiment as bringing people together where they would not be persecuted for manifesting their religious beliefs and being able to conduct their social affairs in ways that are perhaps, distinct and allowed to be distinct. And this to me contributes to some of the undergirding philosophies that many Pennsylvania Dutch people share on both sides of the aisle, no matter where you are these days, that there is this understanding that our ancestors came here for a wide variety of reasons, religious, economic, whatever, but part of that whole process of becoming American was being part of an immigration, by getting here and by being able to share traditions with other people. And those are things that we can all agree on, and things that we can all find common ground to talk about things and share our experiences. And this is also a time where I think, especially since everybody's at home, we're eager to bring these traditions that we're preserving, whether it's the language or seasonal customs or any number of things. People are eager to explore this stuff in their homes, in their backyards, and to find ways to make that meaningful. And people are more cognizant right now of what's going on in the home. So these are just some of my ideas. So
no,
I think we're on the same page here in a lot of ways.
Absolutely. And I think that in two things I would say. One, you mentioned about telling a story. And I still feel that the best way to really get to somebody is through storytelling. I think it's our most innate human form of communication, is through telling of stories. And you could say, well, history is a story. It is. All history is a story. But I think people are so much quicker to sit and listen. We're trained from babies on up, you know, to listen to a story. And I think that's how an easy way for us to, and all of us, those in working in the museum fields, but also like site centers, like what you have, but also as educators, as someone in a classroom, if you present information in a story format, it's so much easier to grab that person's attention, and they'll, you'll get more buy-in too. So I think that's important that to use that as a means of attack, so to speak, to bring your message out. And through COVID, you're absolutely right in the sense that, and I'm learning this more and more as the work that I do with my YouTube channel, particularly the messages I'm getting from people that are getting interested in the videos and the information and the language. A lot of them have absolutely zero Pennsylvania Dutch ties, but they find it fascinating. And because of that, they want to learn more. And they keep clicking on these videos and they'll send me questions like, well, how do you say this? Or why do you say it this way? And here are people that, you know, didn't grow up with the culture, didn't grow up with the language, but have, and they're coming from all over the United States, from other countries that just find our story fascinating. And then you tie that with all of the people that, you know, come from the lost generations of Pennsylvania Dutch, who the kids that grew up with grandparents that spoke it but never learned it, or kids. I get a lot of emails from people from, let's say, California. They're like, well, I'm told that my grandmother was Pennsylvania Dutch. What does that mean? It's like, I grew up in California. My parents moved here in the, you know, 70s or whatever. And there is this constant, I think that's also part of our human nature. We want to know where we came from, and we want to connect to it. And with the internet and with things like what we're doing, it can't be any easier. We've been given a gift to use, and luckily a lot of people are using it for good and are seeing the realization that what you can do with this technology. And if we don't embrace it, it'll, you know, we should slap ourselves in that sense, because we're given a great opportunity and we need to utilize it. And I think most of us that are in the field and doing the work have realized that and are utilizing things to the best of our abilities at this point. So who knows in the future, as things get better, hopefully, and people get out and travel more. Now people that have been in their home learning about all this stuff, hopefully that'll give them that bug to say, well, I'd like to drive to Kutztown and see an actual hex sign in real life, not just an image on a screen, and then get more of the story told to them. You know, that as well as I do, it's one thing to hear a story about something in history. It's a whole other thing to stand in a museum and see it and make that connection, and it makes it real. It's not just a story anymore, and that's the beauty of, like, where, you know, what you do, Patrick, that you have that ability to take somebody out on your site and actually show them, this is what a one-room schoolhouse is, what it looked like. Sit at the desk, feel how the wood is rubbed from all the kids sitting there, and, you know, natural wear and tear. Walk them into a summer kitchen. It's 95 degrees out. Could you imagine cooking with fire and wood in 95 degree heat? This is why the kitchen is separate from the house, you know? And that, of course, makes everything just so much more real. And I think that's also all part of our storytelling. And that will be those people will take home with them and then tell their friends, tell their children, tell their grandchildren, and hopefully start a whole new generation of inquisitive minds, of people that are interested in our story, but then also sharing that, you know, here's where the great philosophy is, that we can all be Americans and truly respect and understand the fact that they're all these little flags or all these little quilt squares on our big quilt, that they have their individuality, that you can see them on a quilt, but when you step back and look at the whole quilt, it makes a bigger picture. And that's my dream, that we can create a society that can do that and respect it and also embrace it and pass it on. So if COVID does all that, that would be awesome. But maybe we've used this time, and we'll continue to use this time to at least push in that direction, maybe, I guess.
I admire the work that you are doing, Doug. You are indefatigable with everything that you do with the culture and the language. You are the biggest cheerleader out there right now, and people have a tremendous amount of respect for your message, and so do I. So thank you so much for joining us today for BCT,
pleasure,
for the Pennsylvania
pleasure.
German
pleasure
Hour.
Pleasure is all mine.
Absolutely. And congratulations again for your award. We're going to
thank you.
You're absolutely welcome, and thank you for all your hard work. We're going to do a follow-up interview as well with Rachel Yoder.
Oh, awesome.
And keep the conversation moving, because you're awesome. Both doing such important work, and we want to hear about the types of art that Rachel is doing in mm-hmm. the home and all of her important work right now. So this is a good time for us to be celebrating this award and your achievement. So thank you very much for joining us today.
My pleasure. Thank you, Patrick.
We'd also like to take a moment to wish a happy belated birthday to our guest today. Doug Madenford celebrated his 40th birthday on July 12th this year. And of course, this is our first opportunity to wish him a happy birthday on BCTV. So howdy to the fort stop, Doug. Now is the time for unser Sprichwort von Monat, our proverb of the month. I selected the proverb of the month in honor of the face mask. Es ist kein Maul zu trauen. You can't trust any mouth. While certainly this old proverb was not invented with the COVID-19 pandemic in mind, it serves as a decent reminder of the potential that all of our mouths have for getting us into trouble once in a while. Mouths do like to talk, and perhaps sometimes more than they should. So it's important to remember for ourselves and for others to know when to put a lid on it. Now for the second half of our interview today for the Outstanding Pennsylvania German Achievement Award from the Deutsch-Pennsylvanisches Arbeitskreis, or DPAC. Today we have the second award recipient with us, Rachel Yoder, the author of Penny Olive and illustrator of Davey Applebutter. Welcome, Rachel.
Hi, Patrick. Hi, everyone. It's so good to be here again.
Thank you for being on the show with us again. It feels like it was just yesterday that we had you on the show reading Davey Applebutter, the year that it came out, and I believe it was 2018. Is that correct?
It was indeed.
So it's wonderful that you've done this work, and it's wonderful that DPAC has been honoring both you and Doug for your outstanding achievements. Of course, these books have become staples among local people who are eager to get the dialect and the culture into the home. So tell us a little bit about your collaboration with Doug for Penny Olive and Davey Applebutter. How did these books come to be?
So a little bit about how Doug and I came to have our working relationship is basically it started on Facebook, actually. I was reaching out to try and find somebody that knew Pennsylvania Dutch and could help me translate my project Penny Olive, which was actually a project in my graduate studies for my MFA program. It was a class called Personal Explorations. So it was basically a project that I wanted to develop, and actually Mikhail Warner helped me as well to develop this project as a way to reach out to contemporary Pennsylvania Dutch children and kind of explain some of the really exciting aspects of our culture. So I designed the project, I wrote it, and I did some illustrations, and then I was looking for a translation because I wanted it to operate on many different levels, and one of them being to introduce children as well as adults to the language. So the book operates as a do-si-do style. So you flip the book around and it's the same illustration, but it has Pennsylvania Dutch on one side and English on the other side. So I was reaching out and trying to throw out some casts to find somebody that could help me with the translation. And Doug said, hey, I'll help. And if you know Doug, which I know you do, Patrick, he is one of the most kindest human beings and most charitable people in our culture and that I know in general. I'm always willing to give a hand. And even though he works full time and has his family and has all his hands in all these different pots, he was wonderful and offered to absolutely help me out. And it was great. So we started a back and forth correspondence on email and got to know each other a little bit and found that we had some common threads. His wife is also an art teacher as well as I. So we had that too. So it was really nice. We're both teachers. We kind of had that idea that as part of our narrative of how we're going to operate in the culture is to be able to help educate people and promote the culture in that kind of way and make it accessible to children especially. So I know he was really excited to hear that I wanted to do it in Pennsylvania Dutch. And also that I didn't want it to just be kind of underneath the English, that it was going to have the same amount of hierarchy as we say in design. So the typography had the same hierarchy as the English, and it was weighted the same because it's equally as important. So it was really important to me in the personal project for my grandmother to honor that. So that's how we came to know each other. Now we've had this budding friendship for this long. It's been so nice. So I guess that was 2000 and 16, 15? It was a long time ago, but yeah. And Doug just celebrated his 40th birthday, which is very exciting. So I'm just a 1 year behind, maybe a couple months, 6 months. So we're the same age too, which is really nice. And that was very exciting. Happy birthday, Doug, or Halika Geburtstag.
Yeah, Halika Geburtstag.
Geburtstag, yeah. And I made a joke with him. I made a video for him because without him, I went right online to YouTube. You know, he makes it so accessible. I was able to practice to be able to say happy birthday to him. I love that about the way that he shares the language is he makes it very accessible and talks about how, like, just a couple words, throw them into your everyday life. And we do that at home, and it's really exciting to hear my kids say things. You know, it's just so funny, the things that my kids will say in Pennsylvania Dutch. So thank you, Doug. But yeah, that's been the way we sort of came together.
Wonderful. Now, do you have any other collaborations planned? I know you did these two very successful projects together. Do you have any other ones planned for the future with Doug?
Yeah, Doug and I are going to continue our Penny Olive and Davey Applebutter adventures. We haven't, unfortunately, with things that have been going on, been able to kind of sit down. I think we were planning to do it in the summer because we both teach and it would have been a nice opportunity. But as you know, and all of our audience knows, it's been kind of a crazy summer. So hopefully within the next year, it would be really nice to release something else where both of the characters are together. Because I think they are, I think we talked about maybe they're cousins. So that's exciting.
That is exciting. That's wonderful. Yeah. Now, when you do the same type of do-si-do format that you did before, where you flip the book around, is that still the trajectory you're on?
I think so, because I'm really, just with my typography education, learning about typography, I'm really interested in continuing to give it the same in the hierarchy of the illustration and the design, to give it the same amount of attention as the English. And I think it's really fun for kids. Whenever I do school visits or explain when I'm vending how the book operates, it's really fun to just show them. And because it's a saddle stitch, you can almost kind of run your finger along and find the other page. Mm-hmm. That's a lot of fun. I loved it. So. Plus, it's just fun to say.
It is. And I love the idea that it implies emotion of flipping the book.
Yes. Out, so. Yeah. I feel like we're going to just burst into dance suddenly.
Fantastic. Well, we'll leave that for Keith Brinsonhoff. I'm sure he'll be on the show next time or something like that, sometime in the future.
And, oh, my goodness.
And we'll leave the dosi going for him.
Yeah, and actually, it's funny we're talking about this because I think our next book, they're going to be visiting Belschnickel, I believe. So We'll see if he makes Wonderful. Another appearance.
Fantastic. Sounds good. So tell us a little bit about the artwork you've been producing lately. We've all been cooped up at home. We've all been spending more time with our families. These are all things that we can relate to right now. But as an artist, tell us a little bit about how things have been for you lately. Are you doing new work? I know we did see some things on Facebook through the PA Americana Festival that Dave Klein organized and things like that. Tell us a little bit about what you're doing right now.
Well, actually, as painful as this whole experience with COVID has been, not that we contracted it, but just as in being isolated and being away from my students and other people, it's been really hard. As an introvert, even though it may not seem that way, as an introvert, I've actually really been thriving creatively. in that all of the buzz and the congestion and the busy stuff is all kind of been silenced. And so it's been really nice. So I've been able to pick up on some ideas and motifs that sort of were put on the back burner with all of the other things going on. So that's been a really nice and amazing experience for me as an artist. But then again, sometimes you get caught up in the emotion and the stress of it. So that can kind of inhibit your creativity. So I don't know. It's been good overall. It's been really good. It was really sad not to be part of the Folk Fest, as you know. That was a really hard time for us in a moment, not just financially, but because I always talk to people about it being like going to summer camp and seeing all your old friends. And I really missed everybody a lot. And especially seeing the folk, like the customers are the best. And it's just, you know, it's an amazing experience. It's just a wonderful event. So that was really tough. And I ended up doing a sale during that time. And it actually worked out pretty nicely for me. And I'm actually sending 5% of it to Steve Sheraton as just a donation because, you know, they've done a great, great service to us and always been very supportive. And we love the Folk Fest. And So that was really exciting. And just kind of developing some, exploring some motifs that I haven't been able to work on in the past. I did a Green Man, which is kind of random. It was actually a commissioned piece, but it sort of opened this whole new rabbit hole that I went down, and I thought, oh, these are really exciting mythical creatures, as you know, I love to kind of develop. So I'm sort of now in a place where I'm working on, trying to work on like a Fra Hala piece with elderberry, and it's all very, very interesting and exciting. So stuff like that, it's just being able to develop things and sort of continue down the rabbit hole and have the time. So that's been very exciting during this time. And then, like you said about the Dave Klein Americana Fest, I developed this piece that I've been sort of obsessing over. It's what I'm calling it the Big Mama Hex, and it's a coupling of some sketches that Frances Lichten did in one of her many amazing template books, where she would give some really cool motifs from different observations, studying all the Pennsylvania Dutch folk art. So it's a pairing of a couple of those. And I love the big, well, I know it's called the Daddy Hex, but the Big Daddy Hex, I don't know, whatever you call it. And it was originally, and I will make sure I'm right on this, it was Johnny Ott's design originally. Yes. And he based it on the European stained glass. Is that correct? Because I just read that in this American book.
he claims, and we have one at the Heritage Center that has his little tag on the back that says that it is the daddy of all hexes, and that it's based on, it comes specifically from a cathedral in Europe. Now, we don't know what the actual specifics are in that, but I, as soon as you said the Big Mama Hex, I thought, I appreciate that that is happening in concert with the idea of the Daddy Hex, because if there's a Daddy Hex, there should be a Mama Hex, right?
Hey, you know, who came first, the chicken or the egg?
Well, and the design that you were using is the rosette, right? And so rosette, to me, again, you've got this really kind of primal, essential geometric form, and so I think it's aptly put. I love that.
Thank you.
I think it's a wonderful thing you're doing.
Yeah, Johnny Ott's an interesting guy. He's very interesting. I'm actually listening back through some interviews I did, and people have some interesting stories. So I find him very intriguing and wild, and the kind of men that I keep company with. So he falls right in line. But yeah, it was definitely as an homage to all of these amazing Hexine painters that have influenced me, and just the idea that you know, I know traditionally it was not females painting, although I'm sure somewhere there were, but yeah, I'm sure you know better than I do, but traditionally speaking, a lot of people will say, you know, the craftspeople weren't typically women, but I feel like, you know, everybody kind of, and I also say about myself that I'm a contemporary Pennsylvania Dutch artist, so I feel like it's very empowering to take those motifs that are more feminine, which I think of as the rosette, you know, flower of life, so.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
To kind of obsess about one motif, it's kind of fun, you know?
Totally. And, you know, there were plenty of female artists. They're not as well documented. And I would argue that part of the reason perhaps they're not as well known is partially because they're not as well documented and not as well represented. And we also will find that historically, a lot of the people writing about these topics were men. 19th century, early 20th century, it was a man's world in terms of scholarship, and we've come a long way of making sure that we're getting equal representation. And in so doing, we can recognize those folks over the time, like, for instance, Weber, who was a Mennonite fracture artist from the 19th century. Wonderful work from Lancaster County, eventually has connections up to Ontario, Canada. You know, great examples of this kind of work exist everywhere. And I'm so excited that you're doing the work that you're doing, taking a look and maybe re-evaluating some of Frances Lichten's work, because Frances Lichten did a lot to really enable the kind of revitalization of the crafts in the early 20th century. So much of what we know right now is informed by what she was doing. Even if people don't know her by name, they probably have seen some of her work or have been influenced by her work. And so that's really important.
Right.
So
yeah, and what I love about her too is that she made workbooks, and the purpose of them was for you to take them and explore these motifs and recreate them, and I really love that. And that's also with our guy, I can't ever remember his name, the Kutztown professor. He had the workbook too. there's a building after him. You're gonna have
to DeFrancesco.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. He was incredibly charitable in that way as well. So.
Absolutely, and I see some of their work as having a lot of similar influence. But she came first, if I'm not mistaken. She came first, and but the reality was that these were both people who wanted others to benefit from their work, not just from reading it and feeling edified,
right.
but to be
right.
inspired to do their own work. Which I mean, that's the essence of art is not just doing it for yourself, but doing it with others and inspiring others, being part of a broader conversation.
Yes, exactly.
Absolutely, wonderful. Well, tell us a little bit more. I guess you've told us a little bit about some possibilities of some future projects, a little bit about what you're working on right now as well. Is there anything that you're looking forward to in this year? Any other online opportunities? Are you going to be giving any presentations or anything like that? Or is there any way that people can learn more about you and your work? Maybe you could tell us that too.
Sure. I started a project called Volkssaga. Am I saying that right? and this was a couple years ago. I kind of started working on different folk tales, Pennsylvania Dutch folk tales or German folk tales. And I made this large body of work that I never really would show or sell. And I just had a pretty nice show at the Firefly Cafe and Outpost in Boyertown. And it was up for a very long time. It was, I think, December through April. And it was a very nice show and seeing it all put out together. So I started to kind of work on that as a collection to make a picture book, a children's picture book, with those stories as well. So they may become a collaboration. I really haven't decided. I've sort of been letting it sit and decide what it needs to do. I don't know. Sometimes projects are like that where you need to give it a little time, you know? So I'm kind of deciding which avenue I'm going to go with that. But I do have the illustrations done. I'm just kind of deciding how that's going to become a collaborative production, so a project. So
that's exciting. That's exciting.
Yeah, it's super exciting. Super exciting stuff.
We need to do more with the stories within the culture because these are so essential. And yet there are people, for instance, who believe that we don't have stories like this.
Ugh.
And there's just, it's so rich, whether you're talking about the Evik Jaeger, whether you're talking about any number of different types of earth spirits and stories of human interactions with spirits and things like that, that would have been kind of classic European folk tales. Folks in the United States aren't always aware of the presence of that here, and Pennsylvania Dutch people tend to also not be so aware of it. And I would say some of this has to do with the fact that the Pennsylvania Dutch culture isn't just one culture. It's many different groups of people together. So you're going to find that there are, you know, there's the Lutheran and Reformed portion of the population. There's the Mennonites, the Amish, all these different groups who have pieces of this puzzle, and it's been fragmented. And so a lot of that's been lost, and I think we're relearning it. So I'm very eager to hear about the stories and the artwork that you've been producing. This is wonderful. Tell us as well, where can people learn more about you and your work?
Okay, so I have a website. It's www.racheljoderart.net. So that's the first place. And then I think I actually also bought bigmamahex.com. And I have Facebook, Rachel Yoder Art. And also Instagram, Rachel Yoder Art. And actually, pretty exciting, I'm going to be doing a series, just a small series podcast called Big Mama Hacks, where I will be interviewing Pennsylvania Dutch people, and it's going to be for an upcoming book of essays and stories about my journey, which I've talked about extensively as well with our interviews of how I came from Bucks County and really didn't know much. And as you were saying, I didn't know any of these stories when I was growing up, and I sure would have loved to know them, you know? Because I always discuss, and this is sort of the umbrella idea of the book, is that I didn't have a sense of belonging growing up, and I really wanted that for my kids, which was another thread in the reason why I wrote Penny Olive, to give kids that connection to their culture. And even kids that aren't Pennsylvania Dutch, regionally, you can be connected to the culture. There's a lot of different ways that you can connect, you know? So that was really something that's been a driving force for me and a big reason why I want to work on this other book. So I'm really excited about that. So
Well, that's fabulous. Well,
Rachel,
absolutely. And we're all looking forward to these works of yours because we want to hear more.
You.
Your voice has been really refreshing to have as part of the artistic community and the cultural community. And so I know there's going to be a lot of eager readers and viewers out there who are looking forward to seeing your new publications and your new art. And we're excited to highlight them again on BCTV when you have more to talk about with us. You're always welcome to join us again.
Thank you for having me again, Patrick. It was so nice to see you again. I feel like we're all friends now.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much, Rachel. And I want to also say congratulations for being a very deserving recipient of DPAC's award for outstanding Pennsylvania German language achievements. It is so well deserved. The collaborations that you and Doug have done together have been just wonderful. Complementary work between the realm of art and language, and we're going to see a lot of impact from these in the years to come as people continue to read your works and explore the culture. So thank you so much for joining us today. It means a lot to us.
Thank you, Patrick, and I want to say thank you to DPAC and Dr. Warner and to yourself, Patrick, and thank you so much for having me again. You always make me feel like I'm sitting on your front porch like Doug's podcast. I always feel so at home, and thank you, Doug, so much, and we all just, it's a wonderful community, and thank you for opening your arms and welcoming us. So, thank you.
Well, we're honored to have you with us, Rachel. Thanks again.
Mach's gut.
Ja, du auch. Schaff nicht zu hart.
Well, liebe Gucke, es ist alles, was mir Hände Maria für die Pennsylvania Deutschstunde on BCTV. Danke auch für Gucke. Und before we go, I just have two announcements to make, one on behalf of the West Berks Versammlung. As many of you know, many of our Pennsylvania German cultural events are being canceled for this season, and the West Berks Versammlung recently released the information that they are canceling their fall event. Every year, the West Berks Versammlung is held on the very first Saturday of October, and everyone from the West Berks Versammlung is looking forward to seeing us all in 2021, again on the first Saturday of October. I also want to let everyone know that Heimatfest this year at the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center is moving online. We will not be able to have in-person programming on site, but you can find many resources advertising our online event, which will be happening through Facebook and other online platforms. You should be able to see some postings in the very near future about some of the speakers and musicians that we're going to have featured for our event this year. Well, zelis alles was mir hen. Bleib gesund, haben gute Monat und mach's gut.
The Pennsylvania German Hour is underwritten by Die Pennsylvanische Deutsche Versammlung von Baddocks County, the state's largest annual Pennsylvania Dutch language gathering, held the first Monday after Easter in the Leesport Auction Hall. For more information, please call Joyce Hassler at 717-866-3431. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the West Berks Versammlung, held annually on the first Saturday in October in Robesonia. For more information, please call Kathy Shellhammer at 610-390-1088. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the Rentschler-Leib family and Reverend Richard Miller and family. The Pennsylvania German Hour is produced in cooperation with the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center at Kutztown University, the hub of Pennsylvania Dutch culture and language. Contact us at 610-683-1589. Or at www.kutztown.edu/pgchc. Mir sauer Großdank zu alle unsere Unterstützer.